I love Romania. This is my fifth trip here in the last 2 years. And every time I come here, I really have a great time. I enjoy being here. And a lot of people ask me, so what, with all your travels in Europe and all that, what's your favorite country? And I always say Romania. And people say, well, why? Romanians say that, by the way. So why? So because I really love the people here. They're nice people, friendly, loving, and all that. So this conversation today is going to be a wonderful thing for us to share together. What I'd like for everybody to do is just kind of turn to the person next to you on both sides and tell them congratulations for investing the time in yourself to be here today. Congratulations for investing the time in yourself to be here today. Thank you. Before I get started, do I have your permission to tell you a little bit about my background and how I got to where I'm here today? Is that okay? Back when I was younger, you know, I come from a very humble family. My parents did not have very high education, and we did, you know, they were okay. But my parents wanted me to be educated because they felt that they wanted me to have the opportunities they did not have. 4 or 5 days before my high school graduation, my father sat me down on the porch outside and he said to me, well, what are you going to do, son? And I said, you know, I always had a love for flying airplanes. Ever since I was a little kid, I wanted to fly airplanes. He says, well, pick something else. He said, you have a choice, a doctor or an engineer. Well, I didn't want to do doctor because I'm not as good looking as Dr. Varga here. I'd have to compete with him. And so I decided to go with an engineer. So 4 years later, I took a certificate that said Nader Ashchi engineer, and I gave it to my parents and I said, congratulations, you are now engineer. So let me go and do business. So I went out and started to do business. And of course I had to work to put myself through college and through education and university. And you know, during that journey, I was able to also not only go to university full time, but I was also able to save some money to start a business when I graduated. So I built a brand new restaurant, which was a steakhouse, set about 300 people and so on. It was a pretty nice little first business. And I did well with it. And I had decided to start something else, and I did not do well. As a matter of fact, I lost everything I had in the world. But when I lost everything, you know, I was too proud. I had too much ego to admit that I failed and I lost everything that I had. As a matter of fact, I did so bad and I lost so bad that I became homeless. I was literally homeless for 10 months. I bought an old car for $400 that was in an accident already. I didn't do it. And that was my home. That was what I lived in. That was for 10 months. This is what my, and I don't know how many of you have been to Florida, but Florida is hot. We have two seasons in Florida. We have January and we have summer. That's it. The rest of the time it's hot. So that's probably why I don't like hot. You know, I like air conditioned low all the time. So anyway, make a long story short, that was an experience, and I was just I had too much ego to tell my parents that, you know, can I come home and stay in one of your rooms? Can I have some money for food? Can I, whatever. But it was a wonderful experience, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as we continue on. So that's a little bit my background, but one of the things that I did do in business, in all of the businesses that I've had, and I still currently own several businesses, hotels and apartment houses, and you know, many businesses that I have currently. I have obviously people that manage all of that. And what I do is I do what I love to do, which is travel the world and share with people information on how to live better lives, how to create their own greatness from within themselves. I don't put it in there, it's already there. During this journey of starting many different businesses or purchasing businesses that are existing, making much better, I found something that people would come to me all the time and say, well, you know, you're doing something different. You know, I have won awards, as obviously you have, you know, in pretty much every business that I've started. And the process of doing that, you know, other people in the same business, whether it's a hotel, limousine service, restaurant, travel company, whatever it is that I've done, you know, people will come to me and say, well, can you help us do the same? There's something special. You're doing something different there, and can you please help us understand? As I'm sure many bankers come to you and say, what are you doing different? Am I right? This happens. When other people want to do better, they go to somebody who's doing what they wish they could do. And so I realized when people would ask me, what are you doing different? The core of everything, it wasn't that I had a limousine business. It wasn't that I had a restaurant. It wasn't that I had a hotel. It wasn't that I had a travel company. It wasn't any of that. It wasn't that I had an internet services, designing websites and hosting and all that kind of stuff. What it was really is my love, my passion for helping other people grow. I realized that there's a deep passion inside me that loves to see other people become better. And so when you are running a business and you're basing your business on morals, on values, on principles, then the rest of it just comes easy. And I was puzzled, you know, when I see people struggling with certain things and they come to me, you know, it kind of puzzles me a lot of times as to, well, why aren't you doing that? And I found out that many people in many parts of the world, and this is not exclusive to Romania, it's not exclusive to Poland or Belgium or South Africa or Saudi Arabia or Kuwait or the United States or Canada or anywhere. I travel all over these places and many, many more. I found out that this is just a generic statement that most people seem to think that in order to create success, in order to get really big, you have to stomp on everybody else. You have to cheat. You have to lie. As a matter of fact, many people who don't have much, financially speaking, they look at somebody who does and say, well, I don't want to be like him because I don't want to cheat people and I don't want to lie and I don't... You know, as if it was something that's a curse. But if you look at the greatest good that is being done in this world, it's being done by people who are successful in other areas of life, who can afford to do good. You know, Bill Gates, you were speaking of, I mean, he donates $1 billion a year to charities. Our founders here of Umanager, they're all successful. They're doing great things for the community and helping people do better. So I learned that throughout this time, and what would happen is a lot of times people would come to me and ask me to help them develop and grow their companies and train. And finally, I just said, you know, I just didn't have enough time. And people would say, well, we'll pay you. I said, really? What I'm doing, is that good? You want to pay me to come to your company? Okay. And I realized as we did more and more of this, that really what I love is not so much the businesses, but I enjoyed going to somebody else's company and helping their people grow just as much as I did in my own company. That's when I realized that it wasn't really about me and about my business, wanting it to be the best, but it's about people in general. And when I came to that realization, that's when I decided that this is something that I want to do internationally. And I set myself a goal. And that goal was to have 1 billion individuals, people, by the end of 2020, that have heard the message of their own greatness. Not the greatness I can put you. People ask me a lot of times, can you change me, do this? Yesterday we were on the TV station, right? For an hour we were on a TV show. He says, well, how can you change people? I can't change people. Elise looked at me real weird. What do you mean? I heard you change people. No, I don't change people. I cannot change people. Because people have their own greatness inside. It's like me saying I can take an orange seed and I can turn it into a tree. Well, I can't. I'm not the one that does that. That seed already has an amazing, beautiful tree inside it. It has all the blossoms and all the fruit, and year after year will continue to give you. I didn't put it there. Somebody else did. I don't know how to do his job. I don't really want it. You see, the greatness is inside people. All I can do is help people create an environment through which and by which they can become their own greatness. I can help you understand how great you really truly are. So that's basically the foundation. And so this is what we do. We guarantee our results. We work with companies all over the world. And you probably recognize some of these companies there. Kentucky Fried Chicken, you know, NBC. We work with Disney, that's not on that seat there. Mercedes-Benz of North America for US and Canada. And right now we're starting relationship with many, many large corporations all over the Middle East and so on. And this is really what we love to do. And the reason that we have grown so fast and the reason why Success Story has become so effective in the training that we do is two things. Number one is the morals, the foundations based upon which we are doing the development process. So training is not training. We don't even call ourselves a training company. We are a development company because we develop people to become who they wish to become and want to become. So there's hundreds, maybe even thousands of companies out there that do training, that they do development. But we have decided to stand aside from the rest. First of all, the foundation of every training that we do, every development program that we do, is based upon, first of all, like I said, the moral values and principles. Now, we each and all have our own values and morals and standards. Mine come from my faith. Mine comes from the Baha'i faith, where based upon which I have developed, and all faiths everywhere have the same concepts, they have the same roots. You know, do good, be kind to each other, love each other. In most cases, you know, many times people come up to me and say, what's the one word, what's one thing that you can put into a corporation and have it succeed? You know, one thing. And when I give the answer, people look at me like, what? And that one thing for me, it's love. If you love your customers, you love every single one of your employees. Now, wait a minute. I'm not talking about the kind of love where you want to go do funny things with somebody. I'm talking about a true, healthy, kind, respectful love that you have for every human being that you come across with their flaws. Because if not, man, I tell you, my wife would have gotten rid of me a long time ago. There's many things that she doesn't like about me, but she loves me. Thank God for that. So here's some of the programs that we help corporations. The main focus that our company does, Success Story International, is really to help corporations grow. And whatever that may be for that particular company, then those are the things we can offer. And those are our areas of expertise. The screen, things you see on the screen are areas of expertise that we do. Now, the reason those areas of expertise are so successful and effective is because of the process that we have created. Like I mentioned, there's two things that, in my opinion, help a corporation become very, very successful. Number one is the fact that it is based on good values and morals. Now, can a company become very successful not doing the right things? Yes. There are some companies out there that can do that. Okay? But can a company organically and in good energy and do good things and have satisfied employees, happy employees that are proud of their company, employees that will sacrifice, will come in early to work and leave late in the afternoon because they love their company, they love what they're doing. Does that really happen? Not in those kind of companies, because they're focused on money. And like Stephen said, when you focus on results, when you focus on taking care of customers, when you focus on taking care of your employees, making sure that there's good systems and there's, you know, it's outwardly. It's something, like he said, that I wake up looking forward to doing good things today. Not wake up, oh, how much money can I make? So that's really the foundation. So how does this process work out? I'm going to go through that very briefly with you. Every system, no matter which of the circle of areas of expertise that we have, every system that we do, it starts with an assessment. There's no possible way I can help anybody go anywhere if I don't know where you are, right? If I call somebody right now and I say, listen, I'm trying to get to Paris, what's the first question they're going to ask me? What's the first question?
Where are you now?
Where are you now, right? There's no possible way. So how can companies that do training go into an organization and say, let me train you on leadership? Well, you don't know what my problems are with leadership. So first thing you got to do is assessments. And those assessments are some of the best on the planet, and they're very, very thorough. The second part of the process is to train the trainer, where we take a few people from within that organization, and we help them prepare themselves so that they can be part of the training itself. Then we do some pre-learning. I'm not going to spend too much time on this process, but the orange one, the training process, that's the one that most companies focus on, sitting you down and training you. But ours is going to be different in every organization, every group that we do this with is going to be different. Why? Because the assessments were different. The preparation is different. The goal is different. Where we are and where they want to go to is different. So no two trainings are going to be ever alike. Anyway, I'm going to skip that. Now, let's get into the meat and potato of what really we're doing here. Okay? We're talking about moral leadership, and that's the topic of today's session. First of all, well, what are morals? There's a list of some morals, and I put them in different colors just so that your eye can kind of catch and separate them. Okay? Prayerfulness. Orderliness, mercy, the idealism, gratitude, forgiveness, enthusiasm, each and every, and there's probably some others that are not on here. But if you can take these and you can build your life, and if you can build your business around, then I believe that you can be very, very successful, contrary to what many people out there in the market believe. We have been trained from childhood that if you want to be successful in life, that's really bad. God wants you to be poor or whatever, you know. It's either bad, you should be ashamed of yourself for wanting to be wealthy and successful and happy. Or if you want to do that and you want to achieve those results, guess what? You got to do some bad things to get there. Not true. See, what is true leadership? True leadership is that there's a huge difference between leaders and those who lead. Everything we're going to talk about today is about those who lead. We're not going to talk about just leaders. Leaders are people that who have been put in a powerful position. And sometimes, even though we may have an option in that, we may have voted for them, but we didn't really know them before we voted for them because they didn't come to our house and have a cup of tea and we chit-chat and talk. And we just believe what they said when they were on the microphone on TV. So even though we may have voted for them, we really didn't know them. We didn't know what they're going to get. So are we going to follow them once they're in office? I don't know. See, leaders are people that when you go into get a job into a company, you have a boss and a boss's boss and a boss's boss. Those are your leaders. Okay, but what we're talking about is leading people. There's a huge difference between leading and being a leader. When you lead people, people follow you. They want to do what you ask them to do. Leaders, true leaders, inspire people. They motivate people. They empower people. They make you feel like you are great. They make you feel like you are capable. They make you feel like you can do anything you want, and I believe in you. I believe in you. I believe in you, Dragos, don't I? Huh?
Yeah.
We had a nice conversation the other night, and Dragos got some beautiful dreams. If we get a chance, we'll let you talk about that for a second towards the end. And actually, they're not dreams. He's taking action on some really, really amazing systems that will help our next generation of children with their minds and with their creativity and with their arts. Just really phenomenal system. Anybody that might have any interest in that, stand up for a second. Just go see this good-looking man. If I get a chance later, I'll have you stop in and just say a couple words if we can. So, see, people naturally want to follow those who lead. Okay, think back about Gandhi. You know, Gandhi started by saying, I want to have 100 million people. This is before Facebook and before internet. You know, we had this lovely lady here. She was telling me that before I get off the stage here, my picture is going to be on Facebook. I said, my goodness, that's terrible. Let me go put makeup on and get pretty and put some cologne so it'll look pretty and all that. But Gandhi didn't have any of this. He didn't have Facebook, LinkedIn, email, nothing. Everything was done by foot and maybe, I don't know, whatever they had back then, donkeys and stuff. But the thing of it is, he had this huge dream. Was it about himself? No. This dream was about making a better world. The kind of world where people seek freedom through nonviolent means. He wanted freedom through nonviolent means. And by the time he was done, he had over 200 million people following. Today, he is well-loved and respected all over the planet. His books, his quotes are everywhere. Today, we saw one of his quotes. Why? That was a true leader. He's trying to do a better thing in the world, and anybody who can connect to that emotionally will follow that. I don't need to ask you, please come do this with me. As soon as you hear about something good like that, you're going to say, well, can I come along? Can I be part of that? I want to be part of that. Look at this new manager process that we have here. This is the third conference in, 9 months? And these gentlemen are doing phenomenal things. Why? They want the people of this nation to understand that we can create success through by being humans. By being ourselves, by being real. Nobody enjoys stealing. Nobody enjoys being mean to anybody. Nobody enjoys being harsh to their employees. And then when they walk away, they're going to feel bad. I'll tell you this, I know that. But yet when you say something nice, something kind to people, you feel good. And you look at them feeling good and you feel even better. You want to do more. And so why not do the thing that feels good if we know that it works? There's 6 leadership dimensions. And by the way, we have workshops and so on, that 5-day workshops that we do just on leadership. And it's a whole process. So obviously we're not going to have the time to talk about all that. But leadership is really not just about being in a position of power and telling somebody else who is answerable to you what to do and how to do it. You can lead your boss. You can lead your peers. You can lead yourself inward and outward, up and down, forward and backward. Forward and backward relates to time. So obviously we're not going to get into all of that, but I want you to understand that leadership does not have, you do not have to be in a position of power. You do not have to be in a position where you have people working under you to say, could you call yourself leader? You can lead anybody on any worthwhile cause, even your bosses and your superiors. I've done it many times, and I know everybody who creates big success does. Silvio has in Microsoft. You've led your superiors because you said, hey, let me show you, and you've expanded. If I understand, when you started, you had 5 employees, and by the time you decided to resign and move on, you had over 400. You did great work in that. Microsoft was very happy, and Bill Gates came here to visit him, yes? So, now, when it comes to leadership, we've developed a couple of assessments. Remember that process of transformation, that process of development has 7 phases. And we've developed a couple phases to begin with an assessment to find out what kind of leader they are. There's 2 types. There's one that is called a skill, which is a person's capability and competencies. What can you do and how can you do it and how well you do that. The other one is leadership style. The leadership style I really cannot control. I cannot change the fact that you're a driver, and you know, like Steve Jobs, he just pushed people, but he's a great leader. He's one of the greatest leaders that the world talks about today, because he took Apple into becoming the greatest company. Now, some people didn't like his style too much because he was hard, but he still was able to get the job done. As a matter of fact, they kicked him out, and then they begged him to come back in again because the company was going down. They knew that they needed. But yet, we have others who do through collaboration, through love, through compassion, through working with their teams. Google is a great, great example of that. A company like Southwest Airlines is a great example of that. Zappos is a great example of that. There's a lot of companies that are, so you can, the style of leadership that you are is really not so critical as the skills that you have within that style. Now here's an assessment. This is an actual assessment from a real individual that, you know, talks about the style of leadership that you have. And as you can see there, it could be a diplomat or a driver or so on and so forth. So this style that you have is really, it just reflects what type you are. And by looking at the assessments of this particular individual, you can see here that this person is a diplomat, very strong in that area. They're competent guide, very strong in that, and they're supporter. So this is probably somebody like Stephen here who leads by compassion and by emotions and so on and so forth. Somebody else could be stronger in a driver, for example, or in a, you know, persuader or whatever the case may be. But that's okay. Now what we do is we take this and we say, okay, now what are the skills that this person is good at? This person happened to have a lot of energy, strong in accountability, motivating others is really, really good, optimism, resilience, et cetera. And they need some support in some of those areas where we have a little bit less. So this is where it starts. The journey begins by trying to understand where you are so that we can create the plan on where we're going to go. So here's a question that was really, really worthy of an answer. And I mean really worthy of an answer. And I don't mean that just by conversation here. You should really ask yourself this question, and not only just ask yourself, but seek and search the answer to it. It's critical to try to find the answer to this question. I have looked for this answer ever since I was a teenager. And I still do. I still do. I've sat with kings. I've sat with presidents. I've sat with some of the top athletes. Today I got to shake hands with another one, and I'll shake hand again. That's an honor, sir. You know, people like, you might recognize Muhammad Ali, let's say. He's been in my home, I've been to his home. We're, you know, known each other for probably a couple decades. But I'm a student when I'm in that environment. Why? Because I want to learn what it is that got you to where you are. Why are so many people more successful than others? Why are some leaders more successful than others? This is very important. And you should be asking yourself that question all the time. And anytime you see somebody in life who is today where you want to be, try to learn from them. Ask them questions. Spend time with them. Spend less time trying to impress them and let them know how great you are, but find out more about what they do and how they do it. You see? Now, why is success a puzzle to most people? How many people are puzzled by success? Let me see your hand. Not sure how to really get all the way there. Yeah, only 3, 4, 10? It's okay, you can participate, really, I don't mind. I like it. How many? All right, better. See, success is not a product of doing certain things. Success is not a product of being a banker. Success is a product of being a banker in a certain way. See, while hundreds of banks all over this globe were going out of business and needing government support and bailouts and this and that, we have some banks in this world that are doing extremely well. Why? Because they had the right people having the right mindset doing the right things. So it's not what you're doing. It doesn't mean that every bank had to go down the drain. No, there's some banks that survived and got stronger during the time where other banks were going out of business. There's Italian restaurants right here in Bucharest that are getting bigger and better and doing better things, and yet there's Italian restaurants right here in Bucharest that are doing what? Going out of business. So it's not what you do, it's how you're doing it. Now, if your desired outcome is this beautiful cake that I can only look at a picture of, I have no idea how to make one of those gorgeous things. Does anybody know how to make one of these? Yeah? Stand up. What's your name?
Paula.
Paula. Everybody give Paula a big hand. Now, Paula, you're the expert here on making a beautiful thing like this. So I need your help, okay? What do you need in order to make one of these?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, just a quick question. Answer.
You need to have a vision, to have imagination.
Okay, you have to have a vision and imagination, and you gotta see. But do you need any of this stuff?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the what to do. You have to take some stuff, right? And if you give this stuff to me, I'll pour it all in one bowl, and I'll give you one of these. Looks great. Thank you. What's your name? Anna. Anna, thank you. Somebody loves me here. See, this is what I would do with it. But if you take what to do and you combine it with exactly how to do it, then you'll get one of these. Am I right? No? You're going to be difficult. Thank you. Send her out. Thank you. All right. If you know exactly what to do and exactly how to do it, you really will get one of these. Now, are you going to get it the first time? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe you have to do it twice, three times, 10 times, 20 times. I don't know. But at some point, if you do what to do and how to do it, eventually, am I right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're my friend now? Okay, good. So we can go have a cappuccino afterwards.
A slice of cake.
Okay, great. So, in my experience, I've learned that there's nine essential strategies to win in life. And keep in mind, everything I talk about, we have to keep the moral values within all of this, okay? So, number one is know your strength and growth opportunities. You got to know what you're really good at, and you got to also know what you're weak at so that you can surround yourself with the kind of people who are strong in the areas that you're weak. There's nothing wrong. Listen, I don't know everything. As a matter of fact, I would like to be the least intelligent person of all the people that I hang around with. Seriously, the people that I am involved with on a day-to-day basis, I like to be the least intelligent of all and the least knowledgeable of all. I just need to know how to be a visionary and a leader and how to build relationship with people and love them and respect them and give them good feelings. You see, I don't need to be the smartest in everything. But when I know what I'm not very good at and what I'm not very strong at, and I help bring to myself, to my team, those who do and know how to do those things, then that in itself is a great strength, isn't it? We were talking with Dragos the other day, and he was telling me, well, I need some money, and I need some IT, and I need this. And I said, no, you don't. You just need to share your vision with as many people as you can, and eventually somebody who has a great IT company is going to come up to you and say, you know what, this is a great project. I want to be part of it. And when you start making money, I want a piece of the action. You don't need money. You don't need an IT company. You don't need this and that. You just need to attract what you need to work with things. So you got to know what you want. How many of you would like, I think you're going to wake up now. How many of you would like 2 million euros today? How many of you would like 2 million euros? See, I told you they're going to wake up. Everybody woke up now. All right, I'm going to pick one to give it to. Who am I going to give it to? You, what's your name? Huh? Stanimira. Stanimira. Stanimira, thank you. You're brave. Stand up. Everybody give her a hand. See, she was the first one that stood up and said me. So I'm going to give you the €2 million, okay? But here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take that €2 million, I'm going to put it in your account. I'm going to use Stephen here to transfer it to you, okay? Because he's my buddy. And you can look at this bank statement, you can show it to your friends, and you have a phone application, mobile applications. Okay, so you can put it on your mobile, you know, smartphone, right? And you can show it to everybody. So look at my account. That's my name, €2 million. Okay? But you can't use the money. You can't do anything with it. You could just have it. Is that going to make you happy? No? You have $2 million. €2 million. Why? I've given you €2 million and you go like this. Why aren't you pleased with it? You can go ahead and have a seat if you like. The fact is, it's not the €2 million that she wants. What is it that you want? Come over here. Come next to me. Come talk to me. I think I'm going to have a cup of tea with her too. We'll go together, the three of us. You give the cake, she gives the tea. We'll have a great time tonight. What do you want to do with this $2 million?
To use them.
Use them for what?
For doing good.
What kind of good?
To help other people to grow, to multiply.
Those are all crazy answers. What specifically do you want to do?
I want to help with some projects in the community.
Like what?
For example, I want to help Vargas Foundation.
Vargas Foundation?
Yes.
What do you want to help Vargas Foundation do?
To help more people in Dristor area.
More people in what?
This is an area in Bucharest, and they need some healthcare checks, and Deland has a list of things that they need.
So what would you do with the $2 million?
I'll give to Varga portion of this, and to Dragos another part of this, and also to some marathon runners who want to become Ironman.
Okay. Thank you. Everybody give her a big hand here. Who else wants to do something big with the $2 million? How about you? What do you want to do with the $2 million?
I think, first of all, I want to help my family. And second of all, I want to help other people.
Now, some people will say, thank you very much. Some people will say, I want a bigger house, bigger car. I want to travel all over the world. And then I want to do this, I want to do that. Okay? But that is really what you want. It's not the €2 million, is it? Because when I put the €2 million in your account, you weren't happy with it, were you? See, that's the thing that we don't understand. And Steve, I think, touched on that quite well, Stephen. That it's not about the money. The money will always follow the dream. And you were asking a question here earlier. So, well, how do I know how long it'll take to develop this? Well, if you take an avocado seed and you put it in the ground, how long will it take for you to eat avocado from that tree? Do you know? Okay. But does a farmer know? Why? Because he's done it before. And that's the answer to your question. Whatever it is that is your idea, you set as close a deadline to it as you possibly can, because you really have no idea. You've never done this before. That's why it's a goal, right? It's a goal because you've never done it before, so now you want to achieve it. There's no way of knowing. You just guess. You best guess at it, and then you try it. How does a farmer know? Well, one of two things. Either he experienced over and over again, and he realized that within 2 years and 3 months, I can have avocados off my tree. Or he asked a lot of other farmers who grow avocados, and they say within 2 years and 3 months, you're going to have avocados on your tree. Which one's easier? Asking. So how long does any idea take to manifest itself is unknown. Now, you got to know your strength and growth opportunities. You have to be driven by a purpose, big dreams. He was talking about the Olympics. These people are not out there because they want to make a lot of money. But guess what? When they win the gold medals, they do, because people want to sponsor them and they want to da-da-da-da-da. They'd make a lot of money. But they don't go into it saying, 15 years from now, if I kill myself every single day, I'm going to make $20 million. So let me work crazy for 20 years, 15 years, 10 years. That's not what happens. They find something they are passionate about, find something they enjoy, find something they love, and they just give it everything they have. They become excellent at it. They dedicate their lives to it. I have a young man here in Romania I met about 8-9 months ago when I was here. He's in Cluj. His name is Vlad Yonex. And when I met him, I met him with his mother and father and a friend that introduced us. And we had a nice dinner at a really nice restaurant. We kept talking about different things. And the mother kept saying, well, he wants to be a tennis champion. And I said, oh, very nice. And then we're talking about other things. And he's practicing really hard. Very nice. And we're just talking about other things and the tasty food and all that. Because I like food, you can tell, right? And finally, I realized that these people are really serious about this kid. And so I turned my attention to him. I actually turned my seat towards him. I said, tell me about you. He says, well, I want to be the tennis champion of the world in 10 years. I looked him in the eye. I said, are you sure? He said, yeah. I said, do you know how hard you have to work to do that? Yeah. Are you really willing to work that hard? Yeah. How old are you? 17. Will you do everything I ask you to do? And when I ask you to do it? Do you want it that bad? I said, yeah. So are you sure? I said, yeah. I said, it's not going to be easy. I told you the same thing the other day, Dragos, didn't I? Because when you have big dreams, they're not going to be easy. You're going to want to quit. You're going to want to stop. You want to go slow down. You can't. You can't. And finally, he convinced me that he had what it takes, and he really, really wanted this. This young man, actually, I got an email from him about 4 days ago. If anybody's interested, I'll show it to you afterwards. I'll even put it on the screen. He is beating one match after the other after the other. And in the beginning, every time he would lose a match, he would write to me and he says, yeah, you know, this was I can't believe I lost this match to this guy who's not as good as me. I said, that's not true. You didn't lose a match to someone not as good as you. You lost a match to someone who's better than you. You just thought you were better. So now what are you going to do? I don't know. Well, you go out there and you practice harder, make sure your angles are... I don't know nothing about tennis, by the way. I played tennis one time and I lost big time. I have no idea how to play tennis. I'm a good racquetball player, but no tennis. That night, that first night, by the way, I told him, I said, on one condition, you do everything I ask you to do and when I ask you to do it. Agreed? He said, yes. So the first thing I want you to do is from this very moment on, when you go anywhere, meet anyone, you introduce yourself and you say, hello, my name is Vlad. I'm the 2017 tennis world champion. And he said, but 10 years. I said, no, it's 5 years. Remember that thing we talked about? How do you know how long? Well, you make it shorter. But at least he's pushing himself hard for 2017. And on his emails right now, when you open his emails to anybody, not just to me, his emails on the bottom says, Vlad Yonex, 2017 world champion of tennis. On all his emails. He has to do that. When I send him an email, I don't say, dear Vlad. I say, dear champ. This kid gets up early every single morning. Before school, he exercises. He goes to school and he comes back. His friends go out and play tennis and basketball and swim and go chase girls and girls chase boys and go to movies and everything else. This kid is spending out there 4 hours every single day playing tennis in the hot, in the cold. It doesn't matter. How many of you believe that he has a good chance of becoming the tennis world champion in five years? Almost everybody here. He's a young kid. He's 17 years old. I believe in him. I know he will. Maybe not 217. I don't know, because I don't have history. But I know he will. And I work with him every other week. I spend an hour with him. My time is very, very expensive, and I don't charge him a penny for this. I do it because I believe in him. I love the kid, and I want him to do well, and I know he will. So it's not just what we do, it's how we do it and how we dedicate ourselves, we dedicate our lives to what we want. See, what happens a lot of times in life is they look at somebody who wins a gold Olympic or is making millions of dollars in sports or in business or whatever, and everybody looks at him and says, look at him, look at the easy life they have, you know. What you don't see is when I was in the back seat of that old car, sleeping, and today my knees still hurt. 30-some-odd years later, my knees still hurt me because of the pain that I had. I couldn't stretch my legs. When you sleep in a car, you sleep like this. And when you're like this for 7, 6, 8 hours, after so many months, it gets very painful. Until this day, I suffer with knee pain. But I've had people look at me and say, yeah, your life is easy. You don't understand what I'm going through. I said, no, you don't understand what I went through. How many times have you been homeless? How many times have you had to buy one loaf of bread and one jar of peanut butter and live off of it all week long? I know what it's like not to have. But I was willing to do what it takes. And it's not just me. This is just my little story. Vlad Yonex is another story. Stephen is another story. Dr. Vargas, another story. Many of you here have your own stories. There are things that you've accomplished that were superhuman, extraordinary in your life. Every one of you here has done something extraordinary. You just don't remember it. Maybe some of you do. But to get extraordinary things, my dear friends, you have to do what? Extraordinary things. Understand and follow the laws of the best 500 companies or top leaders or the best performers in the world. Whatever it is that you want to do and become the best at, you need to understand how others do that very same thing. Plan for success using superior thinking process. See, you have to plan for success. Many people look at an opportunity to say, well, you know, we're going to do this, but maybe not, and if this doesn't work, you will find that some of the biggest and most successful people on the planet, they set a huge goal, and their eyes focus on nothing but that. They leave no bridges behind. They burn them. There is no going back. There's only failing your way all the way to the top. If you fail again and again and again, Walt Disney was bankrupt 6 times before he come up with finally the final product of Disney. And when he finally did go with the Disney, you know how many banks he went to? Steve wasn't there. Steve would have given him the money if he was there. Do you know how many banks Walt Disney went to before one of them said, yes, you can have the money? Huh? 300? Not quite that many, but a good number. 112 banks said no to him. Can you imagine that? How many of us here in this room today we would have gone to another bank and another bank and another bank? 5 banks, maybe 10 banks, some people maybe 20 banks, 30 banks. He went to 112 banks, and finally bank number 113 said, yeah, here's the money. And I have a feeling that he would have continued on for all the way up to 300 if he had to, because it wasn't about the money or the bank saying yes or no. That didn't matter to him. What mattered to him is, this is what I wanted, and if you're not going to give it to me, I'm going to go to her. And if she doesn't give it to me, I'm going to go to her. I'm going to find somebody who loves my idea and believes in me and is willing to support and help. You have to be very effective with your time. You have to be persistent and grateful. Now, effective with your time, I'm sure everybody understands. Persistent, everybody understands that. But why grateful? See, gratitude is the essence Let me give you an example. If you bring me a bottle of water, and I say, thank you. I really appreciate that. That was so thoughtful of you. You know, my mouth was a little dry. Actually, it is. And, you know, I really appreciate you. What is that going to make you want to do? And while I take a sip, I'm going to let you take. What's going to happen to you when I show a lot of gratitude for when you give me some water?
I'm going to feel very happy for you, very happy that I helped you.
Okay, what else happens in terms of future? Would you want to do something for me again?
Yes, of course, and I would want to help other people too.
Excellent. Does anybody agree? Does anybody would do something different than her? I think we all would do the same thing, wouldn't we? Right? When we do something good, something nice, we show gratitude, guess what happens? We get a lot more back again, 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 and again. The more grateful I am to everyone around me, the more I keep getting stuff. And many of you who know me fairly well, there's some of you that we've met many, many times before, known each other for years in some cases, they know I'm always grateful to the busboy, the cleaning person, the sweeper in the floor. I don't care who it is, always grateful to everybody. Genuine gratitude. And for some reason, you know, everybody's wanting to do things for me all the time. I like it. So when you have gratitude, life gives you back. And the more grateful you are, the more you're going to get of the things you're grateful for. That's just nature, human nature. So you got to understand, these laws, I did not create these laws. These rules, I did not create these rules. Something, someone who created everything that is around us created these rules and laws. God himself, when he created man, he created the world, he created the earth, he created all these rules to go with it. Now, whether you believe in the law of gravity or not, whether you believe in the law of gravity or not, whether you know about it or not, it still works. So if you take a little baby on top of a 10-story building and it crawls off of the edge, the law of gravity is not going to say, whoa, stop, there's a baby, and the baby doesn't know about law of gravity. So let's stop the law of gravity in this little spot here so the baby doesn't fall. It's not going to happen. It works no matter what, no matter who, whether you believe in it or not, whether you know about it or not. So there's laws that are existing out there, my dear friends, that are laws of success, laws of prosperity. And not when I talk about success, by the way, to me, success is not money. Success is excellence in everything you want to do, whether it's about your relationships, whether it's about growing spiritually, whether it's about your physical health, whether it's about your business, whatever it is, the same formula, the same laws apply to everything on how to achieve success. So gratitude is very critical. The next one is program your mind for success and solve problems creatively. You see, when you keep telling yourself that I want this and I'm going to do whatever it takes till I become the 2017 world champion of tennis. See, you program your mind. And this is basically what I do with Vlad. Every time we're together, I keep beating his head that he is the champion. He believes it. And all of a sudden, when I get emails from him now, he's doing better and better, and he's winning more matches and more matches. And when he loses a match, he says, you know, yesterday I had a match against a guy who was better than me. But I was watching what he did, and I'm going to learn, and next time I play him, I'm going to beat him. See, it's about learning. So creative problem solving is about, I'll tell you a quick story. You know, in my companies, when I have a big project that I want to accomplish, something really big, and make a huge change and something different, I'll tell my team, I'll say, you know, we're going to have a meeting, and we're going to have two meetings, actually. Today, our first day, we're going to have a meeting to discuss how we can accomplish this particular task. If anybody throws an idea and somebody else says, oh, no, it won't work, because I don't want to hear about that. I only want to hear ideas and suggestions on how we can get this thing done. Now, tomorrow we're going to have another meeting. And tomorrow's meeting, we're going to discuss all the reasons why we should not do this. Tomorrow we'll discuss all the reasons why we should not do it. But today, one focus and one focus only. How are we going to get this thing done? And guess what? We never have the second meeting. They don't want to have the second meeting. Why? Because they focused on one thing and one thing only. How can we get this done? And they come up with so many great ideas that we were able to just launch that and get that done successfully. But what happened here is also they have taken ownership of this great idea. It's not my idea. It's theirs. They've given life to it. Does that make sense? So you have to be creatively solving problem and creating some greatness. Now the next one is committed to excellence and having great communication skills. We've talked a lot about that today and throughout all of our speakers, and we're gonna just scoot on up. Lead others into growth. Listen, my friends, when your focus is not on getting more money in the bank, even though the bank likes it, and it's not about more profits, and it's not about cutting corners and this and that, but it's about really making sure that every person in your organization, every person that you're leading, whether it's somebody above you or somebody that you're responsible for, if your focus is to help them grow, what do you think is going to happen? They're going to love me? Maybe, yes, that's good. But what's really going to happen to that organization when everybody in that organization grows? See, we need to understand one thing. That let's take Google, for example. If we take Google, one of the greatest, as a matter of fact, it's been voted 3 years in a row the greatest company to work for in the world. Why? Because of a culture, of a system that they have in there. And it's a fascinating. You owe it to yourself to learn and study about Google. But if I go in and I take every person out of Google, every person, including the person that sweeps the floors to the president, if we take them all out and go to any country in the world, India, Africa, Bucharest, I don't care where, and just find people in the street, just count however many we need, and we take them over there and we put them in the company, what do you think is going to happen to Google? What?
It's finished, crashed.
Anybody else?
It's finished, I agree.
Yeah. We might as well dig a grave to put the Google in, right? Why? Because Google is not Google without the people. So what happens when you develop people and help them grow? Does that make sense? Most people I talk to, they say, well, I don't want to spend a lot of time, money on my people and training, and because what if they get trained and I spend money on them and they go work somewhere else? Well, yeah, you got a good point. But what if they stay dumb and they stay with you? Is that better? But see, what happened is when you grow and develop people and you help them grow, they're not going to want to leave you. That has been proven. They're not going to want to leave you. There was a survey done with 600 of the largest companies in the world, research that was done, and they asked all the leaders, the top leaders of these companies, they said, what do you think motivates people the most? Your employees, what are they motivated by the most? And they had all these answers, right? And then they asked 12,640 of the employees of the same company, same companies, they asked 12,640 of their employees, say, what motivates you the most? The number one thing that motivated the employees was not even on the top 10 list of the executives. What does that tell you? That tells me that us as leaders in the corporations, and in most cases, not, please understand, I'm not saying it's in all cases, because there are some really, really amazing leaders out there who do great work with their companies. But that tells me that most leaders have no idea what it takes to motivate their people. Would you agree with that? And it wasn't like five employees, they asked 12,600. That says they have no idea how to motivate their employees because they don't know what. And do you know what it took to motivate them? What was the number one thing? Anybody want to guess? Sorry? Recognition? Anybody else? Growth? What, anybody else? Help and grow? Respect? Teamwork? The number one thing that motivated these people was the feeling that they're doing something constructive. The feeling that they're actually accomplishing things when they go to work. That I do something good. I don't just go in and type all day. I actually write letters for whatever, or I help the CEO do this, or I do, you know. It's a feeling that what I do is meaningful. That's exactly what the sentence actually, that the work we do is meaningful. Now, of course, you know, money was there in that top 10 from the employees, recognition, respect. You're right, all of those were in there. Promotions, positions, all of that kind of stuff, that was all in there. But the number one was that. So it is critically important not only to lead others in such a way to help them grow, but also to always look for others that can help you grow. Because if you think you've grown, guess what? You're starting to go down. For as long as you're alive, you can continue to learn and continue to grow. So I've always had mentors throughout my life. And I'm very careful to the advice that I listen to different mentors. You got to be careful with that also. If somebody is a great athlete and has a beautiful, wonderful body, but they're always getting married and divorced and fights with girlfriends or whatever, I'm not going to say to them, listen, you're such a great athlete and you're so good at what you do. Will you please help me deal with my wife? I have this problem with my wife. Can you do that? I'm not going to ask you that. Don't laugh. See, I'm not going to go to Dr. Varga and say, Dr. Varga, will you please help me fix my transmission? He's going to say, get out of here. I fix brains. I fix hearts, whatever, right? Because that's his expertise. I'm not going to go to Dr. Varga and ask him to fix my car. And I'm also not going to go to a mechanic and ask him to fix my heart. Oh, this guy is the best mechanic in town. He fixes transmissions like crazy, you know. So why don't you fix my heart? No. You see, you really got to think about those things. You got to make sure that you know who to turn to for what. And if somebody begins to give you advice in an area that they're not experts in, out of respect, you listen, but you do not apply. Does that make sense? One thing that was found about every one of the greatest leaders throughout history and in the world today is that they make decisions very quickly. Am I right? You make decisions quickly. You know how to make the right decision. Sometimes you have a team that helps you do it. But then they make decisions pretty quick. They don't take their time and, Now they may not apply that decision, but the decision is made quickly. And then they may take and study it and make sure that the decision was based on important stuff. Winning in life is done through the understanding of, the application of, and the habituation of proven success principles. Okay? It's not just important to understand what we're talking about today. Okay? This is just, all we're doing is creating awareness. Nothing I've shared with you today is going to change your life. I promise. I promise you. I'll give you my word. I'll even sign a letter and put my signature and stamp on it that nothing I said today is going to change your life. It will not. It will not make you 1 ounce better, 1 gram better. But applying some of the things that we talked about today, even one idea, you take one idea and you make sure that you're going to apply it completely, is going to make a big difference in your tomorrow. But not just applying it once or twice, continuing to applying it until it becomes a habit in your life. You no longer have to think about it and worry about it. So successful people make a habit of doing the things that unsuccessful people are unwilling to do. They're uncomfortable doing it. Now, keep in mind that it's not saying that successful people happen to like to do those things. They make a habit of it. There's a lot of things I don't like, but I do it. Like you were talking about adventure, go out of your comfort zone, do something that you haven't done before. Guess what? I flew into Cluj one time, I rented a car, and I drove to Bucharest and back. I was a little nervous, I was a little scared, I've never been around here, but I wanted to do that, I wanted to have that adventure, and I felt so good when I got back. I found my way, that was good, I didn't even have GPS. Seriously, it was fun. I don't want to do it again, I really don't. Next time I'll take a train, a taxi, something, you know, because I like to work while I'm. But this was a really wonderful experience. It got me out of doing something I was scared of. So successful people get themselves in a habit. They continue to do something that they don't like if they believe it is important and critical until it gets to a point to where it becomes a habit. And when it becomes a habit, you don't even think about it. Success just becomes a way of life. That's why most successful people, you ask them, well, what is your real secret? So, well, I don't know. I just get up early and I do this. And they can't give you specific step-by-step instructions because it's just become a habit. It's just like me asking you, how do you walk? I don't know. I just get up and walk. But ask a baby, how do you walk? Well, you know, they have to coordinate all kinds of muscles and, you know, but after a while they're running, they're thumping, they're falling, and after a while they stop falling and they just run and thump. Now, these are laws of success. Again, these are nine laws of success that I didn't create, nobody created. These were created when time was created and everything else was. And I think it would be worth everybody's time to really take the time to study and understand and learn each and every one of these. We usually can do an entire day's workshop just on this nine items on the list here today. And I'm just going to run through them, really rush. You know, law of gender says every seed has a gestation period, which means like what we're talking about with you. Everything has a certain period that it take it from where it is to where it's going to be. Well, ideas are spiritual seeds. Our ideas are seeds that are from the universe, right? And how long did it take? I don't know. But you have to be willing to stay with it until it does. Cause and effect. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Relativity. Nothing is so good, nothing is bad, nothing is big, nothing is small until you compare it to something else. All right? This is a big car. Well, compared to what? He's tall. Compared to who? Compared to me, he is. But compared to my buddy Shaquille O'Neal, he's not so tall. You know? So, everything is relative. Perpetual transmutation, energy takes form into physical things. So when you create, everything is created out of energy, by the way. The chair that we're sitting in, the computers, everything around us, everything in the world is created. And if you go down all the way to the main essence of the substance, it's created out of energy. It's just a different way that an energy is formed together that creates it to look like my hand or my fingers or the hair of my head or whatever, my glasses. Polarity, everything has an opposite. If there's a lot of good, there's got to be also a lot of bad. If there's an inside to a room, there's got to be an outside. There's good, there's also got to be bad. Everything has polarity, opposite. Vibration, everything vibrate, nothing sets. Now, again, I don't really have time to go in details, and I wish we had the time. The last one is really one of my favorite, and that's the law of allowance. And that simply means let go and let God. When you have something in mind that you want to get done, Believe in your own greatness. Believe in the fact that you were created as the most amazing, the most wonderful creation God has ever put on this earth. And believe that you too can have anything and everything that anybody else can and have, and even more if you do all the right things to get there. I know it's a little tough for some of us. Some of us are looking at me like right now like, yeah, but you don't know what I'm... problems I'm having. I don't have a job, or I don't have money, and I don't have a car, I don't have you know, it's easy for you to say because you're in a suit and you got a microphone in your hand. But when you make a decision, you make a heartfelt determination that you're going to get this thing done, and you release it, you let God take care of it, because He's in charge of everything. Let Him deal with it. Have faith. Be firm. Know that it's going to happen. Now, what I want to talk with you about for just a couple minutes is about how our mind works, because it helps us to understand, well, how can we control all these things? It's nice to know about these laws and these strategies and how to win and this and that, but I can't get it done. Well, it helps for us to understand how our mind really works. And our mind has, this is a drawing by Dr. Fleet. And basically what he says is that the mind has two parts. And this is not the mind, because nobody knows what the mind looks like. It's energy. It's like saying, I know what electricity looks like. Nobody knows what electricity looks like. Okay, we can see evidence of electricity in the monitor and the lights and hair dryer, whatever the case may be, but we can't see electricity. And this is an image representing the mind. And basically, so, you know, there's a upper part, which is a conscious mind, the lower part is a subconscious mind, and then you have the body, and then in the conscious mind is where we originate thoughts. That's what we think with, that's what we do all our creativity and so on and so forth. The subconscious mind, on the other hand, is our feeling mind, our emotional mind. And if I have an idea and I allow myself to feel good about this idea, the chances of me creating this idea into reality is very, very positive. But if I have an idea, great big idea, and I keep saying, well, I don't think I could do this, you know, look at all these obstacles, nah, I don't have the resources, I don't have the money, guess what? It's not going to happen. It just is not going to happen. You got to add very positive emotions to whatever these thoughts that you're originating, and then you allow your body to take action. The body will take action, positive action, when you have positive feeling. If you feel good, people can look at you from a distance and tell whether you're feeling good or bad. Right? Somebody that walks in the room like this, you think they feel great? Do you think they feel great? No. But if somebody goes in like this, hello there, how are you? Good to see you. Nice to meet you. Thank you for coming. I appreciate you being here today. Right? What do you think that person feels? They feel great. So when you feel good, you're going to take positive action. And when you feel like this, do you want to go do this? No, I don't feel like it now. Well, when do you feel like it? I don't know. What's I don't know? I don't know. Okay. And when you take positive action, guess what happens? You get positive outcomes. Remember that cake, that beautiful cake that we had? It starts with an idea in somebody's mind. See, the subconscious mind is where your programming is. Your mind is programmed, and that's where. Now, what is programming? Programming is a multitude of habits, okay? It's a lot of habits that you have, beliefs, ideas. And the funny thing about it is these habits are other people's habits that have been programmed into your mind ever since you were a baby. A baby born in Saudi Arabia has a different mindset than a baby born in Sweden. And a different mindset than a baby born in India. You cannot take a baby in India when they're 10 years old and talk them into eating a piece of cow. Now, is that right? Is that wrong? I don't know. It doesn't matter to me. The fact is that they have been programmed for certain things. So the values that we have, the programs we have, whether we can and cannot do things, whether we can achieve success or not, whether we can be a movie star or not, we can whatever it is that we want to do, that comes from where? It's from the programming that's inside. And guess what? That programming is done by the time you're 5 or 6 years old. Science has proven this. Medicine has proven this. The subconscious mind, which is the one that drives you as a human being, is determined by the time you're 5 or 6 years old. Now, does that mean that we cannot change, we're done? No. There's ways, and this is what part of our mission in life to do, is to help people understand how to make those changes to those old programming. Okay. Now, here's what happens in general. We see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. And that's how we gather information from our environment, correct? Everything that happens around us, we gather that information from what we see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. But we also have some intellectual faculties. These are like your muscles, your intellectual muscles. Now, if you look at the present, the past, and the future, we use 3 muscles to determine what we're going to do with that. In the past, we use our memory. Think about a lot of times when you're talking to people and you know, in a room, and you get 2 or 3 people standing over here, and they're talking about all the problems. Yeah, this happened. I can't believe she did this to me, and this other guy did that, and my boss did it. You know, they're just nagging and complaining the whole time. And you find these attract each other to each other. You know, they have a complaint magnet inside, you know, like. And then you have these other people, 3 or 4 people over on the other side there, and they're sitting around, and they're talking about, oh, yeah, I went shopping and look at my shoes and look at my dress and there's a beautiful tie and I paid $17,300 for it and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. They're talking about, you know, nonsense, material things. And then you have this other group sitting over there on the other side. They're saying, you know, I'm thinking about this great idea to transform the educational system. Or they're saying, I want to create a new idea in banking, something that's going to be really, really attractive and I want to become the this and that. You see? And you find these people attracted to each other. And I guarantee you, I will bet the $2 million I was talking about, I will bet that for real for you. That what you will find every single time, what you will find is if you take notes of these people that are doing this, that, and that, what you're going to find 10 years from now is those people who are talking about big things tomorrow, they've achieved those big things. These people who are talking about complaining and everything, their life is miserable and they're still standing there somewhere complaining. And these people who are talking about nothing, they're still talking about nothing. That's just how it works. If you live in tomorrow, you live in big dreams, you live in making things better and bigger, then you will. The present is about perception. Your perception of life. One thing can happen, 2 different people look at the same exact thing and they see it in a different way. Automobile accident. One person can come out and cry, look what happened to my car. Even if it wasn't their fault, somebody else's fault. The other person comes out, man, I'm alive, I'm happy. I wanted to change that car, get a new one, so now the insurance company is going to get it. Thank God for that. It's about your attitude. And then you got a mechanic standing on the side there and say, yes, work. Right? Everybody looking at the same exact thing in different attitude, different perspective. So it's our perception. In the future, it's our imagination. What do we create with tomorrow? What do we create in the future? We have to use our imagination. When I was in the back seat of that car living there for 10 months, do you know where my mind was? I promise you, it was not in the back seat of that car. My mind was in the back seat of a Rolls Royce. I promise you. My mind was in the back seat of a Rolls Royce. I do. When I had that, I was completely focused on having my own Rolls Royce with a chauffeur in front of me taking me places. And that's what kept me going every morning and every night and putting up with the heat and the mosquitoes and everything else. This was in 1987. 1993, I had a Rolls Royce and I had a chauffeur and they were driving me places. Now, please understand, I'm not bragging. I'm just trying to let you know that if you have something here and you focus on it and you say to yourself, I will do what I have to do ethically and morally correct, I will do whatever I have to do to get that. I will not quit, I will not stop until the world champion of tennis is me, not me, Vlad. You see, that's the attitude you got to have. You got to be willing to pay the price. Most people look at very successful people and they envy them. They're jealous. Why are they so successful? Why they have a Jaguar? Why they have a Lamborghini? Why they have an A3 Audi? A8, whatever. How come I don't have one? I drive a Dacia, an old one. Why? Well, you didn't see when they struggled to get to where they are. Do it. You can get it. It's yours. You just got to know how to do it. See, here's how our process works. First, it starts with a conscious idea, some kind of thought, an idea that comes into your mind. And then you use your will to concentrate and focus. Focus really hard on exactly what you want to accomplish and get it done. Then you rationalize. See, you can rationalize. You can tell yourself, oh, you know, nobody done this before. This is hard to do. Da, 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 da. Or you can say, you know what? Nobody's done this before. This is really hard to do, and I'm excited about being the first to get it done. See, it's about your attitude. You can rationalize it one way or the other. And, of course, you got to connect. Connect is through your intuition. I like what Dr. Wayne Dyer said. He said, if you praying is you talking to God, your intuition is God talking back to you. I like that. Now here's another way that our mind works, in my opinion. I think that our mind is kind of like this juice machine. And if you look at the conscious mind as being the top part of that juice machine where you put the fruits and the vegetables and all that, and the subconscious mind as the part that actually processes and gets things done, which reality, that's exactly how our mind works, okay? Most of us have no idea and don't really care how that middle part works, do we? All we care about that if I put a carrot on the top, I'm going to get carrot juice on the bottom. That's all we care about. And then, of course, we have to wash it. All right? So the important thing is, for all of us, is what we're going to get, the results. Would you agree? Results is what counts. Results is what's important in life. It's not important how many meetings you go to. It's not important how many hours. If you had a banker, one of your employees, that came first every morning and left last every morning, but always every single day made mistakes in their deposits and all that, and they weren't, what would you do with them? Hasta la vista, baby. Right? So it doesn't matter how hard you work, how much you do, you come in early, you leave late, it doesn't matter. But if you're best, and even if you come in a minute late and you leave a minute early, and every customer that walks into you at your bank counter, you know them by name, unless you haven't seen them before. Then you learn their name, and next time you address them by name, and welcome, and a big smile, and happy, and with pleasure, and kublachere, and all that good stuff, huh? Then you're going to care for that employee. You're going to give them promotion. You're going to love them. Why? Because they're doing a great job. So it's the result that matters, right? It's not what you do or how much you do. So when you want the result, see, you have to decide what kind of input you want, what kind of thoughts you want to plant into it. See, it's those thoughts that determine the results. And most of us, what we do is we have lemon for thoughts, and we want something sweet to drink. It don't work. And if you feel like eating something sour, drinking something sour, great. Don't put watermelon in there. Put lemon. Put sour apple. And if you want something bland with not a lot of flavor, great. Take a cucumber and a broccoli and put them in there. But see, you have to decide first and foremost, what is it you want? And then you have to say to yourself, what must I think and constantly keep in my thoughts in order to get that kind of result? It will not work any other way. See, because when you think these kind of thoughts, nasty, negative thoughts, what's going to happen is you're going to get terrible tasting juice. There's no possible way you can put this nasty apple or this nasty banana and get nice, fresh, juicy, delicious tasting juice. It just doesn't happen. It's not going to happen, right? The opposite is also not possible. You cannot possibly have great thoughts, great fruits, put the freshest, most delicious looking, healthy looking fruit in there and say, I wonder if that juice is going to be nasty, smelly. No, you know it's going to get great stuff. Life is the same way, my dear friends. Life is the same way. It starts with your thoughts. That's what begins the process. See, to be able to shape your future and to create the exact future you want, you have to be willing. Willing. You have to be willing and able to change your programming. And we do this with people all over the world in all kinds of fields of expertise. So unsuccessful people always say, "Ooh, I hate what's happening to me. Oh, this has happened, that has happened." But successful people don't do that, right? Unsuccessful people say, "I had what happened to me." People say, "I create my success. It's my job. I'm in charge. I decide what my tomorrow is going to be like." Unsuccessful people play not to lose. They're always worried about losing. "Oh, I can't do this because what somebody's going to say? What if I lose and somebody's going to make fun of me and they're going to say, 'You're a failure and you did this, you did that.'" If you're focused on not losing all the time, you're not going to create a lot of success in life. It cannot happen. You see, successful people play to win. They're always focused on what must I do to win. And when you're focusing on something, what are you going to find? That thing you're focusing on. Right now, if I told you there's a needle in this room and my baby's getting ready to come here in a few minutes and now I'm afraid that the baby will pick it up and bite it, what's going to happen? Within 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes, all of us will get up and we look at every little corner and we will find that needle, won't we? Why? Because that's what we're focused on. But if we don't focus on that and what's not what we're looking for, guess what? We'll spend another 20 years and it could be right in the corner of this thing here and nobody's going to notice it being there because that's not what our focus is. So you can take the easy way in life or the hard way. See, if you do what is easy in life, in general, life is going to be tough on you. If you do what's easy in life, that's too hard, that's too much, let me watch TV, let me do this, then life's going to be hard on you. And the older you get, the tougher it's going to seem. But if you do what's hard, things that other people are not willing to do, they don't want to do, life will tend to get a lot easier on you. Now, the bridge to winning side of life, there are four aspects to it as human being. Another 5 minutes. There's four aspects to us as human beings. There's three parts of it that are inside. They're part of our inside. And those are not visible. People can't look at me and say, "Oh, you look like a real spiritual person. And you look like, man, you look like you're a brain. You're brilliant. And you look like emotionally stable." Well, not you're really not, but I'm just saying, you know, it's a joke. But you see, those are things that are inside. Would you agree? Now, the outside is the fruit of what's on the inside. Like Stephen was saying earlier, doing the good service and taking care of the customers, taking care of employees, this and that, it results in the fruit of becoming the most profitable, the most successful bank, right? But you can't just look at him and say, "Man, I think..." Well, yeah, with him you can because, you know... Really, I mean, you can't look at him and say, "This guy is an Olympic winner." You can't look at him and say, "He runs the best bank in the area," right? But when you see the external result, the physical results, you're able to do. Now, what is the bridge between what's inside you and the physical results? What's that bridge? Okay, now you know. Tell me. It's action, right? You cannot transform what's on the inside into real results without taking action. That's the bridge that connects you into your desired results. See, we have hidden beliefs, and the hidden beliefs, they're like roots of a tree. And the quality of those roots is going to determine the quality and quantity of those fruits. The hidden beliefs are the ideas that we have, the paradigms that we have, the deep beliefs, the training, the learning that we had since childhood. And those are the things that we believe that this is the way life is. When in reality, if you challenge those and strengthen those, then you get the fruits you want. The only way to go from information to transformation, my friends, is action. Again, winning is done through the understanding of, the application of, and the habituation. You do it again and again and again of proven success principles. Real winning in life, to win in every way, is moral winning. Is winning through morals, through character, through strong values. You can win. You can win in many ways. But will you really, really be winning the game of life? Will you really be having people who love you and respect you and will do anything for you? Will you be one of those people who have made millions and millions and billions and then at your funeral nobody's there except for the ones that want to collect the money? You see, real winning, real leadership is done through morals, through values. Okay. Boom, boom, boom. Now, the last part. I skipped through the previous one because we're tight. It's really important, my dear friends, to set big goals and big values in life, big dreams. Now we have a process. We actually have a 3-day workshop just to go through the process of how to set goals. We help people go and set actual goals and plans and everything else to do that. But I'd like to share a Harvard study with you. They took all these people and they said, you know, how many of you have goals? And 84% of these people, surprisingly, these are Harvard students, my dear friends, 84% of them said, I don't know, I have no goals. I'm just going to go find a job. Like your son was saying, I want to be a billionaire. Okay, how are you going to get there? 84% had no goals. Now, 13%, they had goals, but they didn't have them written down. They say, yes, I know what I want. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to start a company, and then I'm going to work for the, you know, whatever. They had their goals, but they weren't written down. They knew what they wanted. 3% had goals, and those goals were written down. Now, here's the thing that really, really is fascinating to me. They followed up with these people 10 years later. They followed these people 10 years later. They kept in touch with them, and 10 years later, they went and assessed their lives. One of the assessments was, how much money are you earning? And they found out that the people that were had no goals, they averaged, on the average, X amount of dollars. Let's call it $100,000, just for an example, right? So we can have an example to deal with. So let's say they were averaging $100,000 a person. Per year. The people that had goals but did not have them written down, they averaged twice that. So each person in the people that had goals but didn't have them written down, on the average, they were doing about $200,000 a year. Now here comes the biggie. The people that had goals and they hadn't written down, those 3%, they had 10 times the income of both the other to get combined. Which means, if we use the example we did, 100,000 plus 300,000, they were averaging $3 million apiece. This is a study. You can look it up on Google, by the way. You can get the full study, all the research, or the details of it. My friends, find out what you want. That's what I asked you to do, didn't I? Dragos, write it down. I want to see a full description of it, right? So first step, first thing, find out what it is you really want. Make a plan, make a list of it. Decide how you're going to go get it. Now, there's a decision for you to make today. And that decision is, 5 years from now, what would your life look like if you do not apply some of the things that we talked about. And see, this is a commitment that you would have to make to yourself to continue to grow and to continue to learn about what it takes for you to create success. I learn every single day. Research, talking to people, asking, reading, watching documentaries. And the other side of it is, what's going to happen 5 years from now if you do not? If you do not apply and learn and understand and invest in your own self into getting these results. All right. I appreciate everybody for being here tonight, taking away from your time, investing in your own greatness and your own self to be here. And I look forward to catching up with you again. Thank you very much.